When I was a child, my father was a very young novelist. It meant we were poor and we had to move a lot and we didn't have much furniture, but we had a lot of books. It was kind of a private library, and it is like being protected by books and surrounded by books. And for me, books were like a creature, you know, expanding, because the number of the books were increasing, you know, week by week, month by month. So it was like living with them. And I attended 5 primary schools, which could be quite much for a child, but I don't remember I felt hurt, maybe because I was protected by all the books and I spent all month reading books in the afternoon until I made friends. So it is a very precious memory. And I remember one day I was reading a book and I couldn't see the lines. I couldn't see anything. And what happened? And I realized it has become dark. So I had to turn on the light and I just kept reading on. So I discovered books just as pure joy. And afterwards, I became a teenager and, you know, I was confronted by very typical teenagers' questions like, who am I? What I can do in this world? And why everyone has to die? Why human pains exist, or what are human beings and what is the meaning of being human? And then I wanted to search these questions, and I kind of revisited all the books in a new way, and I felt I was, accompanying the writer's questioning, and everything was new at the time. And at a certain point, I wanted to become a writer. I remember the day when I decided to myself to become a writer. It was when I was 14. I just wanted to write my questions. And, you know, at the age, writers are kind of collective, and they were surrounding me together, searching and questioning, and sometimes they felt helpless, clueless. And I just wanted to be with them, because I was helpless and clueless. At the time, I just started to write some lines. Maybe they were similar to some poem. I'm not sure. I just wrote some sentences or phrases, even sometimes just words. And I started to write journal. Until now, I write journal, not every day, but sometimes. So that was all. I didn't start to write fiction at the time. I started to write fiction since when I was 19. And it started with a very short story. And then I moved to a little longer story, and I published some short stories at literary magazines, and I worked as an editor and a journalist for 3 years after I graduated from university, and I really wanted to write my first novel, so I quit, and it took 3 years to finish my first novel. And from then, yes, I have written novels, short stories, and poems as well. So it's like, it's not like I decide to write poems. They just come. And even when I write fiction, poems just come into the fiction. It's like an invasion or intrusion. So, yeah, language is something I have to struggle with, maybe till the end. And there are questions I have had for a long time. You know, since when I was a child, it was very overwhelming to look at human beings, you know, all the things human beings have committed throughout the history and throughout the world. And at the same time, you can see all those such dignified human beings all around the world. So it was like impossible, it was like an impossible riddle for me. And the fact I belong to this human race, and you know, when we are confronted by the horror of humanity, we have to question ourselves that what is the meaning that we are human, and you know, humanity has such broad spectrum. I always wanted to know the meaning. Yeah, so it is like unending inner struggle, because I want to embrace this world and embrace life, but certainly there are points we cannot, and it's like walking back and forth between these two riddles. It's like all my life. But I have this medium, my language, and with this, I have to move forward. It's absolutely impossible, but I would like to, so, or there is no way but to, so. It's always fundamental. All of these questions are so fundamental and so I keep having this deep inside myself, and just I try to write. In 1980, there was an uprising against martial law declared by new military dictatorship in South Korean Peninsula, and in the States kill the people who are against them, and there happened a civilian autonomy, and it lasted for 10 days, and finally the troops came back to the city and they killed again. So we can call it a massacre and a rising and absolute community. I see Gwangju, the name of the city, not as a specific city. For me, it's like a fundamental name or a fundamental noun for humanity, which has these two extremes, from sublimity to the horror or to the basement. So I can see everywhere Gwangju whenever we are confronted by these two extremes. So I wanted to write about that Gwangju, which is coming back to us over and over again. We don't know how many people were killed. Officially it is 200 and some more, but there are many people who are missing until now, so we don't know yet.
But is it thousands, you think?
I think so, but I cannot say because we don't know the truth. I was born in Gwangju, and my family left Gwangju in 1980. It was January. It was so cold, so it was a very cold day, so I remember even the date. It was the 26th of January, and we just left the city because my father had quit his teaching job to become a full-time writer. And he said, now I don't have a regular job, so why don't we live in the capital? It was very, you know, just spontaneous decision. And we moved. And after 4 months, the massacre occurred in Gwangju. Till then, Gwangju was just a small city with some universities, quiet, peaceful. And suddenly, the connotation of the city has become really different. And nobody imagined that massacre. And we can call it an uprising, and we can call it absolute community of solidarity. And it was like long guilt of long period of sense of guilt for all my family. We didn't leave the place intentionally, but it was like that. So it was the feeling that some people were hurt instead of us. It was inside myself for a long time, even though I didn't plan to write about it, never. Just I grew up with this memory which I experienced indirectly, and it stayed in my nightmares. And suddenly, after I finished my fifth novel, I wanted to capture the reason why it is so difficult for me to embrace this world or life. And I had to dig into myself deeper and deeper, and then finally realized that I had to penetrate this doubt about human beings through writing. So that was why I started write Human Acts. And during the process of collecting all the materials, I was even more shaken and torn, because I had to witness all the atrocities. And I had to read. I read a very big book of testimony of 900 people who survived or who were injured or who were bereaved. And it was like collecting all the fragments all together, because I didn't want to write a cold book with evident, you know, incidents. So more I read, more I lost my trust. And at some point, I realized that I was dealing with some people who were so dignified in front of human violence. And there were people who donated their blood to each other. And I still remember the photo of the people who were, you know, lining, were queuing in front of the hospitals. They were so many, and there was a high school girl who was killed after she donated her blood, and on her way back home, she was shot. So. And I wanted to remember this side of humanity and this side of Gwangju. And I started to write the book, and all I wanted to do during the process of writing this book was to experience together, to feel together, and to lend my sensation and body and experience for the killed, and possibly to reach something I found on the other side of this massacre, possibly light, human dignity, or what can I say? Everything sounds quite cliche, but it was so real for me. So that was what I wanted to do with this book. It was the process of transformation myself, and I started with human atrocity, but it was like moving on and on to these dignified people, and I don't like the word victim. It means some kind of defeat, but I don't think they were defeated, and they refused to be defeated. That's why they were killed. Yeah, so it's like coming closer and closer to these people, and I had to move myself from this starting line to the direction to the light, maybe. So after that, I wrote the white book, which is not published in Denmark yet. And in the book, I wanted to write about something nothing can harm or destroy anyhow, and it's inside ourselves. So you can say I have moved forward, and I myself was transformed during the process. And now I'm thinking of love. It's like suddenly I found the meaning of love. And even if we feel pain, it is the proof of our love. But love is still cliche, sounds cliche, but it is real as well. So yes, I always move on with the strength of my writing. So hopefully I still move. Definitely Human Acts is the book which has transformed myself the most. My family doesn't talk about literature. I mean, we just talk about family things, you know? I interviewed my parents. I didn't interview the survivors or people who were injured then, or the bereaved family, because I didn't want to open their wound again. I felt I didn't have any right to do that. So I just interviewed people around me, my friends or elder friends, colleagues, and my parents as well. So I had to talk to them. I was writing this book about Gwangju, and I remember my father told me, "It must be hard on you, but please finish it." So yeah, I remember these words. I remember these words. I hope people who read this book could feel the same way I did. Not only my family, everyone. That's my hope, so maybe.
저의 여섯 번째 장편 소설인 소년이 온다 3장의 마지막 부분을 읽겠습니다. I'm going to read the last part of the chapter 3 in my sixth novel, Human Acts.
눈송이들. 암전 뒤 서서히 무대가 밝아진다. 큰 키에 깡마른 30대 여자가 거친 재질의 흰 무명 치마를 입고 무대 중앙에 서 있다. 여자가 말없이 고개를 돌려 무대 왼편을 보자 검은 옷을 입은 호리호리한 남자가 등신대에 해골을 업고 중앙을 향해 다가온다. 허공을 미끄러지듯 천천히 맨발을 움직인다. 다시 말없이 여자가 고개를 돌려 무대 오른편을 본다. 이번에는 작고 다부진 체격의 남자가 검은 옷을 입고 등신대에 해골을 업고 중앙을 향해 걸어온다. 두 남자는 느리게 돌린 필름처럼 양쪽에서 허공을 미끄러져와 마치 서로를 보지 못한 듯 중앙에서 엇갈려 반대편으로 각각 나아간다. 객석은 빈자리 없이 꽉 차있다. 첫 공연이어서인지 앞쪽에 앉은 사람들은 대부분 연극이나 언론 관계자들로 보인다. 편집장과 함께 자리를 찾아 앉기 전 그녀가 좌석 뒤편을 돌아봤을 때 사복 형사로 짐작되는 남자들이 서너 흩어져 앉아 있었다. 서 선생은 어떻게 하려는 걸까? 그녀는 그때 생각했다. 검열과에서 삭제한 대사들이 배우들의 입에서 흘러나오면 저 사내들은 일어설까? 날렵하게 무대로 올라가 배우들을 덮칠까? 학생 식당에서 카레를 먹던 남자애에게 의자를 휘둘렀던 것처럼 일곱 차례 목이 뒤로 꺾이도록 그녀의 뺨을 쳤던 것처럼 조명실에서 지켜보고 있을 제작진은 어떻게 될까? 서 선생은 체포되거나 수배되어 다시 만나기 어려운 사람이 될까? 꿈속처럼 느린 걸음으로 남자들의 모습이 사라졌을 때 여자가 말하기 시작한다. 아니, 말하기 시작한 것 같다. 아니, 여자는 아무것도 말하지 않는다. 소리 없이 입술을 달싹이고 있을 뿐이다. 그 입술의 모양을 그녀는 또렷하게 읽을 수 있다. 서 선생이 원고지에 펜으로 쓴 희곡을 그녀가 직접 입력해 3교까지 봤기 때문이다. 당신이 죽은 뒤 장례식을 치르지 못해 내 삶이 장례식이 되었습니다. 여자가 등을 보이며 뒤돌아선다. 동시에 객석 가운데의 긴 통로로 조명이 떨어진다. 누덕누덕 기운 삼베옷을 걸친 건장한 체격의 남자가 통로 끝에 서 있다. 거칠게 숨을 몰아쉬며 그가 무대를 향해 걸어온다. 표정과 동작이 초연했던 좀 전의 남자들과 달리 그의 얼굴은 일그러져 있다. 두 팔이 힘껏 허공으로 뻗어 올라온다. 목마른 물고기처럼 그의 입술이 달싹인다. 음성이 높아져야 할 부분에서 신음처럼 끽끽 소리가 난다. 그 입술 모양도 그녀는 읽는다. 어이, 돌아오소. 어이, 내가 이름을 부르니 지금 돌아오소. 더 늦으면 안 돼요. 지금 돌아오소. 최초의 당혹한 웅성거림이 객석을 쓸고 지나간 뒤 이제 관객들은 무서운 침묵과 집중력으로 배우들의 입술을 응시하고 있다. 통로를 밝히던 조명이 어두워진다. 무대 중앙의 여자가 객석을 향해 몸을 돌린다. 여전히 소리 없이 초혼하며 걸어오는 남자를 침착하게 응시한다. 입술을 열어 달싹인다. 당신이 죽은 뒤 장례를 치르지 못해 당신을 보았던 내 눈이 사원이 되었습니다. 당신의 목소리를 들었던 내 귀가 사원이 되었습니다. 당신의 숨을 들이마신 허파가 사원이 되었습니다. 마치 눈을 뜬 채 꿈을 꾸는 듯 허공을 향해 끽끽 소리를 내며 여자가 입술을 움직이는 사이 삼베옷의 남자가 무대에 올라선다. 두 팔을 허공에 휘저으며 여자의 어깨를 스쳐 지나간다. 봄에 피는 꽃들, 버드나무들, 빗방울과 눈송이들이 사원이 되었습니다. 날마다 찾아오는 아침, 날마다 찾아오는 저녁들이 사원이 되었습니다.